So, good morning, everybody. I'm hoping that you can hear me. Do say hello in the chat. I'm just going to quickly check that my video and everything, the microphone and everything is working. So do please say hello. And this morning I'm going to be working on Ryan again. So I've got all my pencils and everything like that on the go. Now, okay, yeah, so do say hello. Do, if you can hear me, do say that you can hear me, because obviously I have quite a few issues with my, in fact I'll just turn my working on. Oh no, you can hear me because I can hear myself. Morning, hi everybody. So as you can see, I've worked a little bit more last night on his face here. This is the most tricky part of drawing a dog. Doesn't matter what colour it is, this bit here and this bit here, well, everything. Everything's really tricky. This I find the most difficult part of drawing a dog, because there are so many different changes in direction of fur. There are so many different qualities of the hair. So the texture of the hair is very different. Up here it's very, very soft. Here it's really quite, it looks a little bit coarse in places. And it's so difficult to get you know, the structure of the face here to look like it's actually, you know, this is the sort of the cheekbone and everything coming in here. And there was a point last night where it looked like he was blowing his cheeks out because I got my shading a little bit wrong. So it's really quite tricky, this bit. And you'd think, oh, you know, you just follow the photograph and everything, and it's, you would think that, but you know, there are so many kind of little tiny nuances in the fur that you know, you just got to get right. So this is kind of what I'm working on at the minute, and I'm using a whole range of different colours. I'll just show you the colours that I'm using. Let me just go to my, so I can sort of, I've got a tin there of all of the different colours. There's pinks, there's greys, there's purples, there's sort of warm greys, there's cold greys. You know, so Susie here, pinched husband's YouTube account. So do, you know, if you've got any questions or anything like that, do ask away, and I will, I'm just going to probably draw for an hour and a half, something like that. Somebody might need to give me a call if I go on too long, because you know what I'm like. I've got a live chat here so I can see any of your questions coming through, and I'm just going to kind of keep going, really. What I'm doing at the minute, you can kind of see these mucky marks here. These have been done with sort of like a warm grey and a browny colour. And I've put these in just to kind of give me an indication of where some of the areas are. It's very easy to be working on something and then come back a few hours later and realise that you've put things in the wrong place. Even if you have an outline of sorts, it's quite easy to do that. So it's important when you've been away from something to come back, kind of have another look, reevaluate, sort of tweak things if they need tweaking. But this is all looking okay. So I'm using a few different brands of pencil here. In fact, I just need to get my sort of greys out. Now, where's that cotton? There we go. So I've got these different ones here, four different brands. So I've got my Polychromos. So this is the Cold Grey 2. I have got the Cool Grey Derwent Drawing. So this is a really nice one. I'm going to be doing a video on this one very shortly. This is a really soft pencil. The Derwent Drawings are lovely, lovely pencils. And on the pastel mat, I can get these really nice details and really light areas over the top of the dark. So they're really good. Of course, I'm using my Caran Pablo. This is the light grey. This is a really good one for, again, over the top of the darks. And sort of, it's almost like a white. It's that pale. And then I've got my Luminance, and this is the light cobalt blue, the Luminance. So I'm kind of using those in conjunction with everything. And then I'm using pinks and blues and purples and whatever else I fancy using in there. I'm using the Faber-Castell, the Faber-Castell Polychromos. They're kind of like the workhorse of my pencils. And I'm just going to use the cool grey now. Oh, hi, Kylie. Oh, that's brilliant. That's so nice that you've been waiting for me. It's always funny, isn't it, to think that people are, coming in at all sorts of different time zones. But I'm just going to sort of very, very lightly start to just plot in this little bit of a light area down here. Now, I do a very brief outline, and my outline is very brief. I don't tend to put much detail in there, and I kind of work out where things need to go by sitting back, looking at what I'm doing, looking at my photo, and just kind of working out where things need to be. So sort of really quickly looking from one to the other and going, oh, hang on a second, I need to get a little bit lighter in there. So I don't really rely on any outlines or anything within my drawing. I get really, really confused, and that's why I can't grid or anything like that. So I just use if I was doing this and I had all of the time in the world, I wouldn't have any outline down at all. I'd start with the eye and I would work out, and that's how I would prefer to draw. And I'd use sort of like measuring tools and that sort of stuff. So working with an outline is becoming easier for me, but it's quite it is quite an alien thing. You know, you kind of get to know your way of doing stuff, but it's quicker. Because you don't have to sit there and measure all of the time. You've got kind of the idea of the shape of the head, all of that type of stuff. But anything in the middle is kind of, I work out where everything goes. So that in here, we've got light, we've got dark, we've got hair direction changes, and I haven't really got anything in this. There's no detail in here at all to show me what's happening there. And that's kind of what I prefer, because I just get really confused with marks on the paper. So I'm just going to bring in this cold grey into here. So I hope everybody's okay this morning. We've had a nice walk. It's looks like it's quite nice, actually. So we've had a nice walk. The doggies have had their breakfast. They've been incredibly naughty and chased the cat upstairs. So my son's putting a new banister on the stairs at the moment, and so they can get upstairs. Oh God, it's like a herd of elephants. They keep on running upstairs. So anyway, they're quiet and asleep at the minute. I don't know where Vincent is. Where is he? Oh, he's over there. So this is the bit where it's a little bit. It all looks a little bit horrible. You know, when you've put your first layers down, it's like, oh God, is this going to work? I hope this is going to work. I should have taken some photos, actually, of this bit here, because it was looking, it was looking pretty, pretty grim, actually, for a while. Where's my blue? So I've got, this is the dark indigo. Now, I don't, it looks quite blue on the film, but actually it's not as blue as on the camera. Not sure why it's quite as blue as that, but I'm adding some reds in here as well, which has made quite a nice difference. So there's sort of some purpley hues, there are some browny hues, there are some bluey hues, there's all sorts of different things in there. And I do quite like to use colour. I do, you know, because there is colour in there, but what I don't want is the Labrador to look blue when I've finished. So I have to be careful to use a range of colours to kind of knock those hues back. You're lucky we're not allowed to walk outside. Oh God, Caitlin, that's horrible. Catalin, I'm sorry if I've pronounced your name wrong. Oh, that's awful. I know that there was. Well, I don't know whether there was talk or not, because I don't listen to the news or anything. That must be really, really tough. That must be really tough. I hope you've got a garden. Sarah Swanson just checking in. He's looking fab. I plan to watch the lives back at the weekend. Oh, that's nice, Sarah. Nice to have you here. Here's Sham, the paper I'm using here. Oh gosh, that was Vinny groaning then. I thought it was somebody drilling, but it was actually Vinny doing a really big moan. He's so naughty. He's like a toddler. Every time you get on the phone or you start talking, fucking whatever. Vinny seems to want to be in the limelight, little rat bag. The paper I'm using, oh, cat, okay, I will do. the paper I'm using for this one is Clairefontaine Pastelmat. So a favourite of mine, can be very frustrating, but I love it because I can build the layers and the depth and everything up gradually. I know a lot of other artists love it as well, and it's a little bit Marmite-y, I think, is pastel matte. You know, you either love it or you hate it, but I must admit I do love it. There are times where I get frustrated, I'm like, oh, for goodness sake, you know, but I think you get that with any paper, really. I think the key for me and how I create something is to use really, really light pressure, you know, until I've built enough depth up, you know, and then I can start to sort of smooth stuff out. But it's understanding that it's going to look a bit grim for a while, you know, and I do try to make my work look as nice as possible. I talk about this quite a bit, actually. I try to make my work look as nice as possible. All the way through, because you know, it's much easier to kind of get on with things, isn't it? You know, if you've got something looking relatively nice on your drawing board, it kind of draws you in. But if you're if you're always struggling with the ugly stages, it can be a little bit, you know, can make you a bit despondent, really. No garden but small patio. Oh, and what sort of dog's Charlie, cat? Is he quite, I don't know how I'd cope if I couldn't take my dogs out for a walk. How do you stop yourself being heavy-handed? I think I'm naturally light-handed anyway. I tend to hold my pencil like this, and it sometimes, oh gosh, and I apologise about I've got raspberry juice on my nails. I wonder why that hasn't washed off. That's a bit bizarre, isn't it? Yeah, I tend to be light-handed naturally anyway, but I think... You've just got to keep telling yourself light pressure, light pressure, light pressure. And it's a habit. It's definitely a habit. Saying that, if you're a little bit more heavy handed and it works for you, then why change it? You know, I know some artists who do the most incredible work and they use really, really hard pressure. I think it's, you know, it's finding what's right for you. You know, and just because I say light pressure is what you have to do, it doesn't mean that that's what you have to do. You know, it's just how I do it. And I always think, you know, you take, if you like what one artist says and you like what they do and you can relate to it, then that's brilliant. But if, you know, if it doesn't really relate, then you can kind of, you know, tweak it so it suits you, you know. And of course, you don't know what my light is because, you know, how can I relay that on, you know, on camera? I mean, my light is, I'll show you my grubby hand, but my light is that where, oops, not even that, where I'm not indenting my skin. So if I was using harder pressure, you know, I'd really be indenting my skin, but that's what I'm trying for, where I'm not indenting my skin. And just practicing that really helps. Oh, he's a Yorkie. Oh, so he's little. So that's a little bit easier for you, I guess, if he's a little dog. You know, I think it must be, although they're still quite active, aren't they? But at least you can kind of bomb around on your patio. So excited to catch this live. It's 12 p.m. here. Oh, blimey. I'm on my terrace sipping coffee and looking at my backyard trees that are flowering. Oh, that sounds idyllic. Hi Penny, good morning. Hello everyone, such a beautiful dog. He is a beautiful dog and it's a gorgeous photo as well. Hello and good morning. How many layers do you have on the ear now? Oh gosh, Mary. I would say I've probably got around maybe 15 layers. I don't really count the layers, but maybe 15. And a lot of them are sort of, you know, there might be areas where there's maybe just about five. And then where there's areas of darker, like in here, it does look very blue on the thing, but areas here and here, I've probably only got about four maybe here where it's softer. So, you know, it's kind of dependent, really. And one of your layers might just be something like this, like where you're just glazing over the top, just to get a sort of like a little bit of extra colour in somewhere. So it's dependent, really, but I don't I don't aim to put a huge amount of layers down if I can possibly help it. You know, it's just whatever the piece needs, really. And my layers are very soft, but there will come a time where I've put enough information down, where I can go in a little bit harder and I can start to add the details and everything. So it's just about adding soft colour at the minute. So I'm using this Caput Morton Violet now over the top of the blue, which is going to give me more of a sort of a almost like a maroony burgundy colour. You know, and then I can put some greys and stuff over the top of that, because if I just put the blue in, he is just going to look really blue. And as I work into the muzzle, if you can see, I don't know if you can see here, there's a lot of pink in here and some warm greys where his sort of muzzle has taken on this, you know, top of his nose has taken on sort of like a different feel. And the pink that I've been using is this is the granite rose, the Pablo granite rose, and this has been a really, really nice colour to smooth down everything. Pablos are brilliant for smoothing, just to smooth everything down a little bit and to sort of knock the colour back a little. So you don't look at it and go, wow, that dog's got a pink nose. It just kind of helps with that nice soft lighting that's coming in around the nose. So this pink has been really good, just to kind of, you know, help with the smoothing and everything. Thank you Rob, that's really kind. I love your comparison pastelmat to Marmite. Every second post on Facebook seems to be about this controversial paper. I can't imagine using anything. It's funny, isn't it, Anita? It's you know, and I do think it's to do with you know, your techniques and how you like to work. And you know, if you're used to a smooth paper, or you know, you're even just starting out on your coloured pencil journey, and it's more about sort of, you know, you're just trying to get details in, then the pastel mat is going to be a real frustration, because if you try to put details straight in onto pastel mat, it's just not going to work. And then you're going to feel, you know, really, really frustrated, because it'll look horrible. And this is kind of where I go back to trying to make everything look nice, you know, again, you know, where you kind of do things so it looks okay, rather than having it look awful all of the time. You know, and there are little tricks you can do to kind of help with that. Hi Skylar, wondering which pencils do you choose, which brands to use before you start a portrait and stick to them? No, I don't. No, I try to, and it's very difficult really, especially if I'm going to be doing like, so if I'm doing an online workshop and people want to know what pencils I'm going to use beforehand, the majority of the time I haven't actually drawn the piece. So I'll look at the photo and I'll go, oh, that, the other. But then what happens is I change my mind as I'm drawing, because I'm like, oh, this would be quite good and that would be quite good. So I kind of have an idea in my head about what I would use. But I very rarely stick to that, because I just go, oh, I'll just use a bit of this and I'll just use a bit of that. And I can very easily start on one part of a portrait, and end up with, you know, using some pencils, and then end up right at the bottom using completely different colours. I get the same, you know, I get the same effect, but I'll be using completely different colours. So, you know, I mean, I can stick to just the colours I've picked, you know, but I just like, oh, I'll just use a bit of that. Oh, I'll just use a bit of that. So it's not very helpful, really, is it? Hi Susan, loved your business on how to use Instagram and didn't know you were from a marketing business background. Oh yeah, I've done all sorts of different things. Well, the marketing side of stuff kind of comes from, I was the studio manager of a big studio for a number of years. So, you know, kind of the marketing side of stuff kind of comes from there. And I've got a qualification in marketing as well, but it's just one of those online things. And I went for the exam. You know, I don't know whether you know, but you know, when you go and do your when you go and do your driving test, you go to one of these test centres, and it's like, I think the ones in the UK are called Pearson, something like that. And I did this online course, cost, I don't know how much, 300 quid or something like that. And I watched about three of the modules out of about 30. It was very naughty. And then went and did the exam and passed it with distinction or something like that. I can't remember, having not done much of the actual watching, because I find the marketing side of stuff and using social media, I guess because of the stuff that I've done in the past, I find it sort of quite second nature as to how things work and what you should do and all of that type of stuff. So, yeah, so I have got a qualification in marketing. And then I used to do, you know, a lot of marketing in previous jobs. But the coaching side of stuff has been, you know, the thing that really... I think really turned me as a person around as well. I think I really kind of got to grips with who I was once I started doing all of the coaching qualification. So it was quite a big qualification, a degree level qualification. So you had to put an awful lot of work in and do all of the sort of, you know, go to all of the different lessons and stuff like that. So that was a big, big, big thing for me. Hi, Alana. It's looking. I joined your Patreon last week and it's already helped. So, oh, I'm so pleased. I'm so pleased. Yeah, it's yeah. Do you know, Patreon is such it's a fab platform. I know sometimes it's a little bit awkward to kind of maneuver around, but it's such a fantastic platform. And you know, it's really nice to kind of be building that community as well, and having what happens is people join, and not only do you get sort of, you know, advice and help and everything from me, but you get advice and help from all of these other fantastic artists who have been with me for sort of, you know, just over a year. You know, they start to kind of pass on their knowledge as well, which is just brilliant. You know, so if you're doing like some sort of a tutorial or something, and you're struggling with it, and someone else has done the same tutorial, you know, they will come in and they'll help too. So it's just a brilliant, brilliant community of artists. It really is. It's such a nice place to be. So, you know, I hope you continue to enjoy it. I've got some really nice tutorials coming up. So that's gonna be fun. Oh no, that's not good in Malaysia. That's not good that you can just go on the patio. That is sad. How do you keep track of the pencils you're using? I'm a beginner and have trouble with matching colours I've used on previous area. I would say the best thing to do if you're struggling to kind of remember which pencils you're using, and it's a little bit slow, but I would say write it down or have like a swatch on the side of your paper. You know, just write it down what you're doing. So this is your first layer, this is your second layer, this is your third layer. And what will very quickly happen as you do more and as you put the drawing hours in, what will quickly happen is you'll start to recognise your colours. So you'll start to, you know, not have to write your colours down. You'll just be able to kind of pick from, you know, from experience, basically. But that's quite a good thing to do, is to have, you know, have a list of your layers and just write those down. And then you can kind of use that as almost like a recipe. You know, and you can do some swatching as well on the side of your, have a scrap piece of paper on the side of your drawing and have it almost as like a little recipe card. It's quite a good idea. I just tend to wing it most of the time. And that's why I can end up with, you know, using one set of pencils at the beginning and then completely change my mind. But you get a similar colour, you know. So, but it's, yeah, it is frustrating and a bit challenging when you're first starting out, trying to work out which colours you want to be using. Lovely drawing. I can use poly light flesh instead of granite rose. Yes, you can. Yeah, absolutely. So the light flesh is the, I don't think I've got one here, but it's that light pink. So absolutely. The reason I'm using the Pablo is because it's just a bit more velvety. So it will smooth out with not a huge amount of pressure. You do sneak out for a few minutes with your little dog. Oh no, that's no good. Yes, just be very careful. I would watch all 30 videos and still fail. No, you wouldn't. Oh, dear. No, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't. You have to have that mindset. You know, you have to have that mindset that, you know, it's all going to be okay. So, you know, that's my mindset all of the time. It'll be fine. What's the worst that can happen? Be fine. And I always think there's a reason for things as well. You know, there's always a reason for something happening. Oh, that's all right, Tracy. I really enjoy doing the live streams, I have to say. I do enjoy doing them. You know, it's nice to feel that you kind of, you know, you've got people around you. Not that I get very lonely, because I'm really, really comfortable in my own skin. I'd be really happy just sat in my studio, just doing drawing and, you know, listening to, you know, the radio. Or what I've been listening to at the moment, I've been listening to Outnumbered, you know, the TV show on BBC. I don't know how many times I've watched that. I just absolutely love it. About the family, the crazy, crazy family. And it's so realistic. So I really like that. So I'm just really comfortable in my own skin. I'm happy just, you know, sitting, just doing my own thing. But equally, I'm really happy to kind of be chatting and everything as well. It's, it's nice to have a bit of company. Oh, camera to go with your recording and such. I purchased one. Ooh, that's exciting. Oh, that is exciting. Oh, well, hopefully you'll start to be doing some videos then, and we can all join you as you're drawing. It's really tricky, actually. And it's something that I'm going to be doing some videos on my Patreon about what equipment for recording your videos and everything, and the editing software and stuff, because it's an absolute minefield. You know, you just don't know, and there's loads of videos out there kind of showing you what to use and how to use them, but it's never really geared for artists. And then you'll see a load of them where they just shoot straight down, and that's really easy to, well, it's not easy, but it's much easier to set up your camera equipment when you're shooting straight down. I draw on an angle, so it's really, really hard to, you know, work out how to set my camera and everything up. And then once you've set your camera up, then what? You know, what do you shoot through? How, you know, what software do you use? Do you just go straight from the camera? It's really tricky. You know, and then how do you edit your photos? And then nobody ever tells you how long it takes to upload your photos to YouTube. And when I first started doing my videos onto YouTube, I'm like, oh my God, it would take half a day to upload my videos to YouTube. And I was using QuickTime to record my videos as well. So I'd record for half an hour, and then I'd have to spend another half an hour saving the video, because QuickTime was so slow. And it was just like, oh my goodness, you know, there must be an easier way. And you've got to kind of go through all of the pain to work out, you know, how to do it. So I've kind of been through all of that pain, and I've got a system that works quite well now. But it's, you know, technology can be real tricky. You know, something doesn't work, it can be really, really frustrating. Going to be making a pencil holder, especially for keeping a palette of pencils handy and selling on my... Yeah, that would be amazing. I'm just going to have some tea. Because I was thinking about the same thing, Rob. Oh, a good cup of tea. It's not cold yet. I was thinking of having something like a sling around. I'm going to give you all of my ideas now. Somebody will come out with a sling for pencils. But I was thinking about, you know, something that you kind of have in front of you where your pencils can kind of just sit. Because I've got pots and I've got jars and I've got that pencil. Oh, I haven't got it here, but I've got like a little pencil caddy where you can just stick your pencils in, which is great. But a lot of coloured pencil artists hold their pencils in their hand like this, you know, and they hold it close to them. And then you end up with shoulder pain and arm pain and everything. So something like that would be amazing. So I'm still not putting detail in here. I'm still just adding colour. It must be like watching paint dry, to be honest. watching all of this. I did some videos on machina embroidery, spent a whole day for a 20-minute video. Oh my goodness, I know, it's mad, isn't it? Absolutely mad how long it takes to upload something to YouTube. You know, and then it's all of the different file, you know, file types as well that you have to use, and the MP4s and this, that and the other. And it's like, oh, goodness. So, and then some of the editing programs as well are so tricky. Just end up, yeah, exactly. I mean, I've got like a little drawer underneath my drawing board that I've got like my little pot with the pencils I'm using in, but I tend to have them in my hand, which just isn't a good idea, but they're just so handy. And it does, that it's not a good idea to hold them in your hand, because you do end up with arm pain. So I'm just adding a little tiny bit of detail into here. So what I've done is I've put enough colour down so that my pastel mat is actually smooth, but I still haven't put a huge amount of layers down. And then I can just start to gently bring in some of these little areas of detail. And it's not really detail, it's more sort of tone, you know, where the shadowy bits are. And then you kind of have to sit back and just make sure you've got those in the right place. And then you find you haven't got them in the right place, and you have to go, you have to colour over the top of them again. I think that's why I like pastel mat as well, because it's so forgiving. Making mine out of wood with holes that grip the pencils. Oh, that sounds interesting. Susan, I'm using Polychromos, Pablos. I've got this one, which is the Derwent drawing. This is the cool greater Derwent drawing, which is a really great pencil for getting those highlighty bits on. And it's very soft, so you're going to get sort of like a smoother, creamier finish on your paper. But I like to use these a little bit later on, because these over the top of the harder pencils, I think they work better. You know, if you go in too soon with a creamy one, then I kind of get a funny feeling on the paper. So I tend to use them a little bit after. Don't think they will be as good as you, though. And yes, that is true. Definitely a process and need to go. Oh, no, they'll be amazing, because what they'll be is they'll be you, you know. So everybody who does videos, it becomes you and your style. And you'll have your followers, and they'll be following you, you know. So I think it's always difficult to not to compare yourself to other people, but you know, you're always going to have your personality coming through, and people are always going to relate to that. So, you know, you should never not do something because you think somebody else is doing it better, or somebody else is doing it, so why bother? Because there are so many people out there who, you know, want to learn and want to do stuff. So it's, you know, it's all good. And plus, it's, you know, it's how artists develop. Some artists want to go on and do videos and teach and do YouTube and all of that type of stuff. Others don't, you know. Others are you know, happy just doing the commissions, or I'm saying just doing commissions, it's really tough doing commissions, but you know, it's all dependent. And I think you do find quite a few artists end up you know, doing YouTube and wanting to teach and everything, because that's kind of a natural progression, really. And you will have people asking you, you know, you know, I think it's good. And I think it's good for development as well, you know, because you have to keep learning, and you have to keep sort of almost reinventing yourself as well, because, you know, if you're teaching people, they're going to want to know more. So, you know, you've got to keep on sort of giving different things, and that kind of pushes you to do, you know, to do things and develop and all of that type of stuff. So I think it's all good. Not sure on the ideal amount of holes, though. Oh, I'm not sure. Well, if it's anything like me, Rob, then you'll need probably about 150. Work for a nightclub company, have my pencils in 8 tequila promo cups. Ooh, that sounds fun. Empty ones, Katie. Just bought a little wooden cube with 12 compartments in to keep the pencils in. I'm using on that portrait. You can get about 8 in a hole. It's really good. Oh, that sounds good, Penny. How many of the Derwent drawings do you use? I've never seen those before. Mary, so in this one, whether I've got some different ones on there. On this one, I've got these three at the moment. So I've got the cool grey, I've got the ivory black, and I've got the ink blue. There are 24 in all. So it's quite nice that there aren't like a huge number, because you can buy a full set and it not feel like, you know, you're kind of breaking the bank. And they're all really nice colours, but they're very soft, you know. So if you like a harder pencil, then you might not like them. I like a harder pencil, but I'm starting to kind of see, you know, how the softer ones can really help with my work. That's good, Susan. Oh, I'm pleased about that. Do you have a video on drawing the eyes? Yes, I did a live stream on drawing these eyes on Facebook. So you can catch that on Facebook. And then I've got some videos on YouTube for drawing eyes. My Patreon, I've got absolutely tons and tons of tutorials on there now. And they're literally from start to finish. So I'm thinking, I don't know whether anybody's interested, about doing another draw along, and we're going to do cat eyes. So I did spend some time taking pictures of my cat yesterday, because she's got the most beautiful eyes, and it was completely disastrous, and she looks like she's got weird eyes. So I thought I'd pick a picture from Pixabay that I've used in a workshop before, and we could do cat eyes as a live draw along. I thought that would be really fun, because cat eyes they're not easy to do by any means, but you don't have any of this weird eyelid stuff going on with a cat usually. They tend to be sort of like a nice shape. So I thought we'd do a draw along live doing the cat eyes. So if anybody's interested in that, you know, let me know, because I think that might be quite fun. Empty, unused, Day of the Dead, Halloween comes. That's hilarious. I see a lot of questions asked about how to do this or that, and sometimes there isn't an answer to a particular question asked. So I think I will do a tutorial on that. Yeah, exactly. You know, so it's and what will happen is, you know, whatever tutorial you do, people will keep on asking the same questions. I've got a whole massive ream of huge long list of the stuff that I want to do, and it's fitting it in. It's, you know, and I've got a, once we're out of lockdown and everything like that, I've got a purely because I need to go and see my web developer, but I've got a beginner's course that I'm going to have over on my website, and that will be from the very, very basics. And in fact, I'm kind of doing that on my, I've got two Zoom workshops, 2nd of May and 9th of May. And I'm kind of doing the real basics for that. You know, so the reasons why we put down sort of like the pencil like we do and all of that type of stuff. So it's, you know, the basics I think are really, really important. You know, and understanding why, you know, a pencil is laid down like it is, and, you know, all the sorts of different ways of doing stuff. It's really hard for somebody just starting out in coloured pencil to understand, you know, why, what is layering and why do we layer? And, you know, you'll ask the, or people ask the question, and then I'm like, oh yes, you know, coloured pencil, it's all about the layering. Well, what's layering? You know, I don't, when I first started, I was like, what on earth's layering? You know, so I think that's quite a good thing to kind of concentrate on. Yes, do a draw along. Another draw along would be great. Yep, would love a draw along. Cat eyes. Oh, brilliant. Got a cat with crossed eyes. Yeah, that would be interesting. Yeah, cat's eyes would be great. Yeah, they're blue eyes as well, which is quite nice. Just use a jam jar for the pencils. Yeah, that's what I use. I've got some really lovely jars, Emma Bridgewater jars, and then I've got some just normal jam jars. Hi, Nick. How are you? So Yeah, so lots and lots of things in the pipeline. I need to sort of crack on with this black lab really, because I've got a chocolate lab to draw, and I'm supposed to be drawing a swan for Patreon for May, and it's I keep looking at it and thinking, oh crikey, I'm not really sure where to start. I keep on having these amazing ideas. Oh, I'll draw this and I'll draw that, and then I tell people I'm going to do it, and then I'm like, oh my goodness, I don't know how I'm going to do that. But I did that with the ram, and that kind of worked okay. So, you know, the swan I'm going to do using the Icarus board, which I know not everybody has got, but you'll be able to do it without the Icarus board. But it's an amazing photo. It's black sky, bright white swan, black water, and sort of white reflection. So that is going to be a really, really interesting piece to do. And I'm going to do it on drafting film, but I'm still kind of in my head working out how I'm going to do it. And I think I'm going to have black paper behind it to get the real depth, the real darkness. So we'll see. We'll see what happens. I'm supposed to have that for the 2nd of May, which is like next Saturday. So need to crack on with this boy, because I don't really like, well, I've got two pieces on the go at the moment, this one and the Pine Martin that I'm doing as a workshop. And then I've got another workshop on the second, where we're drawing a little Shetland pony, which I'm really looking forward to, because it's a really, really nice photo actually that I took. I'd forgotten I'd taken them, and I was going through Lightroom yesterday and I was like, oh God, these are good photos. Oh, and then this afternoon I've got a Zoom drawing pause. So I'm busy, 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 busy. It's no rest for the wicked, that's for sure. Do I like the slice tool on the pastel mat? I do, yes, but I don't use it as much as I do on the film, because with the pastel mat, I like to kind of make my marks mostly with my pencils, whereas on the film, it's much easier to get that sort of like texture and everything. So, but I used it quite a lot on the ram, I have to say. I used the little precision tool, and I used the manual pen cutter, and they're both really good. So I know this is really slow going, and I haven't done a huge amount. Kind of done this little bit here. But it is quite slow going, you know, and it's definitely worth taking your time doing stuff like this. And like I said, I don't have any of the areas on the dog's face, you know, where I know I'm putting shadow and light and everything. It's just blank. So I'm kind of having to work with my reference photo, sitting back and making sure that I've got things going in the right direction. Yes, get on with it, Bonnie. Yeah. Oh dear. So true. I don't understand layers at first either. I mostly drew with graphite years. Yeah. So, and that's the thing, isn't it? You know, and everybody layers differently, you know, and it depends on the paper that you use as well. So I think it's, you know, it's good to have a, you know, to watch a few different artists to see how they work. You know, because we all kind of interpret things differently. And I know my drawing style has changed. You know, and I do now really concentrate on the tonal values and everything quite a bit, rather than, you know, sort of working on the details and stuff. And I think that kind of comes with, you know, drawing hours and, you know, kind of understanding how things work, and also understanding your paper. You know, and I think as well, the more drawing you do, the more you see, so you can kind of see all of these little nuances and how things work, whereas I wouldn't have seen half of these, you know, sort of 3 years ago. Oh, I've just found a really, when I was going through my Lightroom pictures yesterday, I've got the most gorgeous photo of a cat that I took when I was taking some photos of some dogs for a portrait. I was going through these photos looking for paws. So I'm drawing a paw live this afternoon for Patreon. And I've got these really cute spaniel paws that we're going to be doing. And I came across this cat, which it's climbing down a red brick wall. And having done the horns, I'm now thinking how fun it would be to draw those red bricks. So, and he's got this gorgeous tabby cat. So I'm thinking I may well draw that just for me. I don't know whether people would be interested in that as a tutorial, but I may well do that as a, I don't know. But it kind of appealed to me. You know, it's just really nice, this cat climbing down the port of the wall. And it's all in focus, which is unusual for my photography. So I'm kind of thinking about that. And then I've got so many things in my head that I want to do, and it's just, you don't have the time. So, and I don't like to speed processes up either. People could say, oh, you know, just whack some pan pastel down on this and then put the details on the top, and it's just not the same. It's just not, it doesn't work the same for me. I like to really, really take my time, and just the whole process of the creating in colored pencil is kind of what really appeals to me. That's what I really love about it, that it's slow and you can kind of get completely immersed in it. Thank you, Tessa. What's a good brand of pencils for animal portraits that aren't too pricey? I'm planning on upgrading to more professional art supplies. Well, I have just bought, and I must test them out, but I've just bought these. And I've heard from a couple of people that as a budget pencil, well, you can see these, as a budget pencil, oh, they're really dusty. These ones are supposed to be quite good. So I thought I'd do some testing with those. Put them back up here. They're the Lyra Rembrandt Polycolour pencils. But I would say you can't go wrong with using your Faber-Castell Polychromos as a first set of pencils. But also, you know, using your Prismas, the Prismacolor, they're not cheap, but they're a good pencil. And you know, I know people go on about the light fast qualities, but they're not that bad. It tends to be sort of like the light purples and pinks and the light blues that are a bit suspect. But, you know, I would say anything that, you know, and you don't have to get a full set. You can just buy a few single pencils, you know, just to kind of get you into it. But the Faber-Castell Polychromos, I think, are a good pencil to start with. You know, and then as you kind of get a little bit hooked, you know, you can start to sort of look at the other brands as well. But they are a good pencil. I must admit, the first pencils I bought were, I think I bought a full set of the Caran d'Ache Prismalo, which are the watercolour pencils. And I also had a full set of the Kohinoor, which I don't think are artist quality, but you know, they were okay, and I used them quite a bit. And then I kind of discovered the Polychromos, and then I kind of built on mine from there. So you know, you can buy them singly. What colour is that right now? Oh gosh, you'll have to ask again, Mary. What colour was I using? I don't know. I'm using black, I'm using blue, I'm using there's a cocoa, Pablo cocoa, and then I'm using this red one, which is the Caput Morton violet. The Prismacolors have got a really, really good, I mean, I think the Prismas must have the best range of colors. They've got some awesome colors in there. They're very soft. You know, so for animal fur, I don't think they'll be very soft. I think they'd be fine. It kind of depends on, you know, what you like. Hi, Meng. Is it possible to use watercolour pencils together with polychromos? Yeah, Yeah. So a lot of artists do use the watercolour ones. So Claire Milligan, she uses watercolour pencils with hers, and she uses it sort of wet and dry. There's Shanna Lee Hartshorn, she uses coloured pencils wet and dry. You'll get the, you can use watercolour as a base. So you can put your watercolour pencils down as a base, activate them then with water, and then put your dry pencil over the top. You can mix and match. They work really, really well. It kind of depends on what your, how you like to use stuff. So it's good just to have a bit of a play, really. Hi, Darlene. Sure, watching other artists is a great idea. I also follow Patricia. Oh my goodness, her work is and it's watching her work and seeing her work that makes me just think I need to do pastels, and then I remember that I can't use pastels because they make me lose my voice. Her work is unbelievable, off the charts, incredible, and everything's like gigantic. It's a hugely enormous, but I really, really like her work. Cat sounds pretty cool, would make a good drawing. I think so. It's a really nice composition. You can't see its face or anything, but it's creeping down the wall, and I really like the kind of the softness of the fur, in with the sort of like the rough wall, because it's sort of like a red brick wall, but it's quite interesting, and sort of the textures and everything. I quite like the sound of that, so we'll have to see. I've got a load of commissions coming up as well. And then, of course, I'm doing these workshoppy things too, which I do like doing the workshops, though. I do like kind of, working with others. And Zoom actually works really well because you can do it like a draw along, and people can kind of pipe up and ask questions, and it all feels much more like an actual workshop. And you can kind of then do sort of like a critique at the end. It's quite nice. I do like it. This is the Caput Mortem Violet that I'm doing here. I'm sorry it's so slow. I'm not doing very much. But it's just, it really is about building up this nice texture. And the colours and everything. And then you can bring in some of these. What have I done with that one? I put it back in there. Oh no, it's there. I'm going to just bring a little bit of sort of smoothness into here. And then I think I'm going to bring in a bit more of that dark blue. So you can see it does... it does take a while to build up the layers, but then once you've got the layers in, you can really start to bring in some tiny, tiny details. Let's get rid of these dotty bits. Just take that out a little bit. Is your draw along this afternoon on Patreon for a higher tier? It is, Joni. It's on the $20 one. I do like a live draw along every month. But this one I'm going to do, and usually I do it on YouTube, but because Zoom has been working really well. Oh, am I doing it on Zoom? No, I'm doing it on Zoom. We can fit sort of like 100 people in. So if every single person on that $20 tier wanted to come on, then I'd still have, I think I've got 90 people, something like that, on the $20 tier. So, they could all get on if they wanted, but I doubt whether they'll... I'll probably have about 20, 25, something like that, hopefully. And I'll record it as well. But the that the $20 tier is quite it's been quite popular actually. You know, because we do the live draw along, sort of some collaboration and all of that type of stuff. So it's pretty good. Would it be possible this video later again? Oh yes, yes, of course. Yeah, it'll be on YouTube, so you can watch it again. Yeah. Oh, thank you, Meng. What was that eraser you just used? This is my this is the putty eraser. So it's a Faber Castell one. Let's get the box. So it's this one. Comes in a little box. I find that is the best one, or for me anyway. And you just sort of squish it around. I tend to use the whole thing. So I find that a lot of people just kind of break off a little tiny bit, but I like to hold it in my hand, squish it a bit, and then sort of like draw with it. You know, so. Where can I find Patricia? I'd love to check her out. Have a look on Instagram. She's got an Instagram page. Her work is, oh, it's just honestly out of this world beautiful. Really is fantastic work. And it's pastels, not colored pencil, but it's really, really good. But they're like they're about a cat portrait. It's about 3 foot, 3 foot by 3 foot. They're enormous. Right, let's get a little bit more pinkiness down in here. So the Pablos really are a nice pencil to work with. They're really nice and soft and velvety. So just sort of getting that little bit in there that's sort of like a pinky browny colour, and then we'll come in with sort of a bit of black and blue over the top, just to sort of knock it back a bit. Do you have a wait list for the higher tiers? Sorry, just drinking my tea. Yeah, I have a wait list for the top tier. So I only tend to have between 5 and 10 people on that top tier, which is the sort of coaching tier. So it means that everybody gets, well, you get whatever you want really during the month. Critique, coaching, you know, whatever it is you need. And that I have got a wait list for. The $20 tier, I tend to just kind of leave it. And then if people leave or kind of jump down a tier or something like that, people tend to just grab one as they come up. And then I may well add in maybe 10 places in that one, because I know there are quite a few people who would like to go onto that tier. But I guess because of what I do, it would be a bit tricky to kind of have too many people in, because then if everybody wanted to kind of get onto some of these live draws and everything, then they're not, it would be hard to give everybody the attention, you know. So I kind of try and keep it sort of like capped. But I might add in a few more spaces in there. But it's just a case of kind of keeping your eye out, really, and when a place comes up. Okay, so we need to do something with that, because that's not working very well. I've not heard of Julie Rose. I'll have to go and have a look. There are some amazing artists out there. There really are, you know, so inspiring. And it's funny, you end up sort of like, you know, following your little small circle of artists, and you know, if you spend some time on Instagram and you go and have a look on their explore bit, you know, you can find some incredible artists. I really like I really like to follow artists who are very loose, you know, with their materials, so much more sort of impressionist. And I quite like abstracty stuff as well, I have to say. But and I love watching people do paint, you know, when they do these paint things and they're just sort of throwing paint around, and you sit there being mesmerised how paint's sort of moving around, and I love those sorts of things. Or sculpture, I love sculpture-y ones too. Not sure who that is. Somebody from Spain is ringing me. That's another really lovely thing, actually, doing what I'm doing, because you get to speak to people and you become friends with people all over the world. You know, I'll have conversations with people from Australia first thing in the morning, and it's so nice. You know, to feel that you've got friends everywhere. You know, it really is. It's lovely. And that's one of the things that I hadn't realised I'd get when I started my Patreon channel. I hadn't realised that that's what would happen. I thought I'd just be shoving videos up every month and that would be it. But it's not. It's really not. You know, I spend a whole load of time doing different things. But I hadn't realised the kind of the camaraderie and the people I'd meet through it and get to kind of know. And I think that's what's made it so nice. So this is warm grey. I think what's happened here is I've put this a little bit too far in. It needs to go out. So I just, and this is what's really nice about the pastel mat, is that you can kind of just cover up those bits. So I don't have to erase it. I just cover it up. That's better. And then I can put this black bit, it's more sort of here, I think. And this is why it's really important for me to be able to kind of see the whole piece as a whole and work on it, because I don't rely on sort of marks on the paper as to where everything's going to go. So you kind of just have to do a bit of a switching between the two. That's a bit better. I think it's always good as well to kind of show when you go wrong, you know, because I don't think anybody's perfect in what they do, and I think it's good that oops, paper's popping up. It's good when things go wrong, because you can kind of show how to get it back. Oh, thank you. Oh, you're the only to me. That's really sweet. Oh, yeah. You can see how that's start, how it's starting to kind of come together. I know it's really, really slow. And it is really slow. With something like this, you know, it really does, it's worth taking your time. And then when I come down to this bit here, this you know, the area below his face onto his sort of chest and everything, it will probably get a little bit quicker, because the hair is much coarser, so you know, you can bring in a coarser texture, whereas the hair on his face is a really, really light, fine texture, and you've got to kind of relate to that. And then I've got this line here. Who knows what this line is? But I have a habit, if there's a line somewhere, I have a habit of working it into the drawing. So I'm just going to take that out a little bit, because I don't know what it is. So we need to get rid of that, because otherwise I'll incorporate into the drawing. I don't even know what it is. I think it was probably just a So I'm going to just put a little bit of red in here, because this is the, this is kind of the edge of his sort of, the edge of his, where his lip is and cheek, is it, yeah, the muzzly bit. So I'm just going to bring that in there a little bit. So, and just bring that bit up there. So I can get that, I can get a real feeling for what his face is doing. And I'll just bring a little bit of grey in there. The other thing with pastel mat is that it can, you can end up with marks on it, scratches on it, that you don't realise are there until you actually draw over the top of it, which can be really, really, really frustrating. And the best thing to do if that happens, if you're drawing away and then it's like you've got this massive scratch, is not to panic, because when you panic, you kind of do stuff that is, you kind of just do stuff that you don't think about. And you just randomly start to try and fix whatever it is that has gone a little bit wrong. And actually the best thing to do is just to put your pencils down and have a really good think about how you're going to get over whatever it is that's happened. So if it's a scratch on the paper, usually you can kind of get away with it and you can kind of work around it. But the worst thing you can do is to try and sort of like fill it in, because you'll end up with a line, you'll end up making the line even, the groove even thicker. So you're better off just kind of putting your pencils down, having a good think about what you're going to do. And that's the same if you go wrong, you know, if you feel you've gone wrong with something, the best thing to do is just sit down and make yourself like a little bit of a plan as to how to get back from where you were, and be rational. I think sometimes when we go a bit wrong and things don't go as we planned, we become really irrational. And the first thing that happens is we end up blaming ourselves for being useless. You know, it's like, oh God, I'm so useless. I've done it wrong and, you know, I should have known I couldn't do it. So you've got to be really careful not to kind of blame yourself for stuff, because, you know, mistakes happen. And, you know, it's what we're doing here and putting the pencil on the paper is hard. It's tough work. You know, I mean, this is a tricky area to be working around here. So to be kind to yourself. And now I'm looking for my cold grey four. Where are you? I don't know where it is. Oh, cold grey 3 I'll use instead. Delimitation. I'm back. I had to help my daughter with maths. Oh, gosh, Rob, that doesn't sound very nice at all. I'm so glad that my children are a bit older and that I'm not having to homeschool, because I don't think I could. I honestly don't think I could. My heart goes out to all of these people who are trying to work from home, who have younger children, who are actually having to supervise them and, you know, with the stuff that's going on online with the schools. I just don't know how people can do it. My 15-year-old, he was supposed to be taking his exams, his GCSEs, which are obviously all cancelled. So he hasn't got anything, you know, school-wise to do. That's what he's telling me anyway. And I'm so glad I don't have to supervise him. So yeah, my heart goes out to you helping maths. Oh, Denise Wanless. Oh, she is just amazing. I love Denise Wanless. She has the most beautiful style. It's so soft and detailed, and it's just, oh, absolutely gorgeous. That she is definitely one of my favourite artists. Really, really lovely. I love seeing her work on Instagram. Ah, that's nice, Dolly. Yeah, we like, I think, you know, I think like attracts like. I think, you know, if you have nice, kind people, because I'm so lovely and nice and kind. but it attracts other people. And I like to keep things a bit positive, you know. I just want to be happy with what I'm doing and in my work and everything. And I know we're going through a very weird time at the moment, but you know, doesn't mean to say we can't all be a little bit positive and stuff. I know some people struggle a little bit more than others, but I was saying on Facebook yesterday, it's good to practice being positive. It's good to practice, you know, being kind to yourself. And, you know, if you constantly find yourself almost giving yourself labels about, oh, I can't do this because of this is, you know, this is who I am or this is how I am. You know, you've got to practice putting other labels on your head, other hats on your head, if you like. You know, people who aren't particularly confident or who don't have much self-belief, it's you can start to change that by just changing your thinking habits and changing your mindset. And it's not easy, and it's something that you kind of have to do every single day, but you know, it does work. You know, if you're naturally a more sort of anxious person or a stressy person, you will naturally be thinking stressy and anxious thoughts and reacting in a particular way to you know, certain circumstances. So if you start to try and change the way you react, or you practice reacting in a different way, or telling yourself different things, you know, in your head, then you can actually sort of change your behaviour a little bit and find it easier to be a bit more, you know, have a little bit more self-belief and a little bit more confidence. And but I know it's a long road and it's not easy, but you know, you can do it. There's all sorts of little exercises and stuff you can do as well. So this is starting to work quite nicely. I need a little bit more shine in there, so I think I need to bring this bit in to be able to then work on that bit a little bit more. I tend to find that I need to put surrounding areas in to be able to get other areas to work. Oh no, supposed to do 10 A-level exams, but they were cancelled. 10? Oh my Lord, well, I'm so glad they've been cancelled. I think it's been really tough for, you know, the students who are doing A-levels and GCSEs and stuff, because, you know, you've been working really, really hard towards them, and then all of a sudden you don't have them. But my son doesn't seem to be particularly worried about it at all. So he's changed into a night owl. He gets up at sort of, I don't know, midday, and then he doesn't go to sleep until sort of really, really late at night. I do think that's how teenagers work, actually. So, and then my eldest son has made a bed. He's taken the banisters off the stairs. He's repaired the wall. He goes out running. He's made like a mini gym in the garage. So he's been pretty good at kind of finding stuff to do. Right, we need to get this darker here, so let's just get a few little guides in so we know what we're doing. Probably sitting here thinking, my God, what the hell's she doing? All she's doing is just whacking a bit of colour down here, there and everywhere. I'm gonna have a bit more tea. I need to get that nose in as well. I like to have the noses in quite quickly, because it can look a bit funny, can't it? Leaving the nose too long, it's like leaving the eyes blank. I always think, oh, it's like a zombie. Oh well, that's good. Yeah, your predicted greys are better. That is good. I was terrible when I did my, well, it was O-levels when I was at school, and I was supposed to be revising, and I just read all the Julie Cooper books. I got five O-levels, and it's silly, because I was, you know, very bright. I was top of my class when I first joined school, but then, oh gosh, school and me just didn't go. Quite a bit of a rebel, really. I was, Vincey, I was nearly expelled as an 8-year-old in junior school, and spent most of my time outside the headmistress's office. just because I was just really naughty. I recall I took a hamster into school once as well, I think, and had it in my pocket. So I always had animals and stuff, and I grew up over the top of a restaurant. My mum and dad had a restaurant, and I'd stolen a big catering box of after eight mints. I think I was about eight or nine, and I took them to school and was selling them all to all of the other children. So I got into trouble for that as well. I was always in trouble. But now I'm very law abiding now. I don't like to go against rules. But I was very rebellious when I was little. Always great to watch you. Fantastic. It was always just something for the future. Would you consider doing a Black Panther? Ooh, yeah. Black Panther would be good, wouldn't it? Yeah. I've got a Jaguar to do, but a Black Panther would be really nice. It's all those gorgeous, gorgeous colours, because the fur is really dense as well, isn't it? A bit like cat fur is so different to the canine, the dog fur, because it's so dense. You know, the hairs are so fine, so that would be a good one to do, I think. No revision till final year at uni, spent exam leave, riding my horse, exactly, Katie. Well, I left school at 15, so and then did 2 years at college, which I feel, well, I don't suppose they were completely wasted, but and then just went straight on to work. I was much better once I started working. I think you know, finding a job I enjoyed was you know, but I always worked really long hours. When I worked for a company for 14 years, and I started off as a typesetter and then ended up as like an art worker on a Mac, and they had three shifts going. So they got the early shift, which started at 6 a.m, and then you had the day shift, which was like 9 to 5, then you had four shifts going then, and then you had the afternoon shift, which started at 1. And then you had the night shift, which was, I think somebody came in at about 11 o'clock and worked through the night. And I ended up the majority of the time starting work on the early shift at 6. And I was still there, you know, at 9 o'clock at night when I was supposed to be, well, even later, midnight, when I was supposed to have gone by sort of 1 o'clock, just because there was so much work to do. And I really, really loved, working. And loved what I did, so you know. But my goodness, it was busy. You'd have a stack of work to do, and then, you know, you'd end up being broken off all of the time to do like the really urgent stuff. But yeah, it was good. It was really good. I've got quite a good work ethic. You know, I do work quite hard. Black Panther, great idea. Yeah, I think what we should do is Jason Morgan should do one in coloured pencils, and I'll do one in pastels with a big mask over my head. I'll put like a big sock or something over my head so I can breathe, and yeah, we'll see what happens. Although, I mean, he's a dab hand at coloured pencils as well, so. I've been looking into how to live stream, you know, two people in different locations, so. That's something that we should definitely do. That'd be quite fun. I even rebelled against doing art. I had 2 unconditional offers for foundation art, but went off to do a 4-year degree in equine studies instead. Well, yeah, you know, and sometimes these things, it's right at the time, isn't it? You know, I don't think anything's ever wasted. I'm sure you don't regret doing it, but it's, you know, sometimes it's not the right time to do, you know, what you end up doing eventually. And you'll have learned an awful lot anyway, Katie. So if you did equine studies, you're going to be learning more about horses, which is going to help you with your equine portrait. So it's all good. All right. I keep on getting memories up on my Facebook about my horses. So I had horses up until 2016. I used to compete all of the time, be out twice a week competing, and Yeah, it's quite sad seeing them cropping up, actually. Remembering what I used to do. And how thin I was. My God, I was thin. So, mucking out two horses, riding two horses, competing two horses, I was really thin. I'd have to get a big cart horse now if I wanted to ride. Yeah, it is. I'm a really positive person anyway. I always have been. I don't like to feel sad and I don't like to feel anxious, which I know seems a really weird, silly thing to say, but I just don't. I don't like to feel, you know, that horrible feeling you get in your stomach, that awful feeling of dread. I just hate it. I've managed to find a mechanism of being able to switch it off. And I think a lot of the coaching stuff really helped. The NLP stuff really helped. Now I've kind of taught myself to realize that if there's something I can do about something, then I will. You know, so if there's a problem and I can fix it, then I will. If it's something completely out of my control, then there's nothing I can do. So, you know, the lockdown, what's going on at the moment, there are things I can do, so I can keep me and my family safe, and I will do those. But apart from that, there's nothing I can do. And listening and watching constantly the news, I think can make you more anxious. So I just don't, you know, and anything that's sort of, you know, a bit sad or horrible or whatever on Facebook, I just scroll past. I don't even go and have a look because I don't want to feel horrible and anxious. And I guess some people might say I'm just, you know, putting my head in the sand, but I just don't want to feel that way. So, you know, I'm just doing stuff that makes me feel good. You know, and that's kind of what I do throughout life. If I can do something about something, then I will. And if I can't, then I'm not going to worry. So, but that's me. I do get cross about stuff, you know, so there will be times where I'm like, you know, I do get a bit, you know, mad about things, but then it doesn't last very long. So, you know, if I lose my temper, then 10 minutes on, it's all forgotten. You know, I don't bear a grudge or anything like that. You know, so, but it's all dependent on your character and everything as well, isn't it? So I'm a very easygoing, laid back sort of person. Love competing my horse. I've got an X-Racer. Oh, that's brilliant. I had a little X-Racer as well. Not only women can multitask, oh no. Oh, that's nice. I had a little X-Racer. He was absolutely brilliant, really good jumper. Yeah, nearly 11 p.m. So there's a lot of night owls around working late on. I do like to work late into the night, I have to say. I get really restless legs. It's not that I get tired. I just get restless legs and then I'm just like, no, I've got to go to bed. My wife teaches them and just helping my wife. That's funny. Totally understand that. I avoid Facebook. Yeah. Well, I love looking at Facebook, but what I've done is because I've been avoiding all of the news and everything and just concentrating on art pages and stuff like that, what happens is I just get those coming up in my Facebook feed. So I just get people's lovely art to look at, which is really nice. Or the other thing that I do is watch TikTok videos, which I just think they're absolutely brilliant. You know, the things that people are doing whilst they're stuck at home is just amazing. I just love some of those videos, and they're getting all of their families and everything involved, and it's fantastic. You know, I it's such a weird time, isn't it? There's such horrible things going on, and I know that, but actually, because of all of these horrible things that are going on, there's some amazing things that have happened. And I love that sort of spirit that everybody's sort of, you know, getting together and doing stuff with their families and everything. I just think it's brilliant, absolutely brilliant. I had someone on my Facebook feed yesterday, a friend in, she lives kind of in the same area as I do, and her family, very musical family, have done a video using Take That Shine. And they've used it for the virus, you know, and it's fantastic. And that's kind of been on the news and everything locally. And it was, you know, it's just brilliant. I love how everybody's kind of getting together and that kind of community spirit. I think it's so good. Oh, they're leopards, black leopard. They're definitely called black panthers though, aren't they? But I think they are sort of like a darker leopard. But that would be really good to do with some really nice colours in there. Yeah, I've got a jaguar that I'll be doing very soon. I'm hoping to do that for the Sketch for Survival. It's a really nice one. It's got all like the greenery and everything behind it, which I think could be quite good. I'm just going to put a bit of this in. I'm not sure how much I've done in an hour and a half, not much. So I need a bit of purple in there, I think. That's so funny. People rolling their eyes for other people taking credit. We had a date with Bridget Jones last night. So I'd said to my daughter, well, let's watch Bridget Jones. So tonight we're watching Bridget Jones 2, which is I'm looking forward to. I'm also looking for this new it's not new, it's the second series of the Ricky Gervais, it's called Afterlife, that's coming on tomorrow on Netflix, so that should be quite good. The first series was really good. So I'm just glazing a little bit here over the top of some of those colours with this purple, just to kind of bring out the colours underneath. Oh, experts always get annoyed about this stuff though, Rob, don't they? They always get annoyed about things. It doesn't matter, does it really, if people call it a Black Panther? So. I'm kind of switching now between the different colours just to sort of get a bit of smoothness in here. Yeah, so if anybody's interested in that cat one, I might do that next week. Might do a live draw along with the cat. I'll put something out on my social media, and it'll just be two. I don't think we'll do the fur in between. I think it'll just be the eyes. But if I go with the one that I did in my workshop, they're blue eyes. It's a picture from Pixabay, and like I said, I tried to take ones of my cat and it didn't work at all. And they're just really nice blue colour. So I might put something out for like a live draw along session, and we should be able to definitely get one eye done, if not two, in a couple of hours. So that'll be quite good. Oh, bye Lily, nice to see you. Tiger King documentary, oh my goodness. That is just, we started watching it because we were like, oh, everybody's watching this, we need to watch it, it's supposed to be really good. Oh my word, what a program. Just unbelievable. I mean, you know, none of them had any teeth because of all of the drugs that they'd taken. It was just A completely different world. Just weird. It's definitely worth watching, but it's an experience. And I must admit, it's very sad actually seeing all of those, the tigers in. I mean, he reckoned that he was sort of like, saving them from extinction and all of that type of stuff, but they were in such tiny cages. Very sad, very sad. Oh, Welsh D. Oh, that sounds nice. Oh, that sounds lovely. I love a Welsh D. Mine was, I had a little ex-racer called Rocky. So he's down south now, retired. He was only little, he was about 15'3". And a brilliant, brilliant jumper. His dressage was fab as well. So I won quite a lot with him. And then I had a big dressage horse called Mitch. He was Trakehner. And then I bought another Trakehner, and who ended up being gigantic, and he was called Elf. And so we backed him. I bought him as a 2-year-old, well, just under two, and we backed him. And but he grew so big, so he was like 18'2" when he finished growing. It was massive, but he was the most beautiful boy. So I don't ride anymore, which is sad. But hopefully I might at some point. Right, so these are starting to come together now. Let's bring a little bit more of that blue in there, and then I will finish up soon and say goodbye. But I hope this has been useful again. Oh, that's Vinny moving around. He's like a blooming horse. Take him for a walk, he's like walking a racehorse. He's about the same size as well. I know, it was. It really was, because, Carol was saying that she was rescuing them and they were all in the wrong, but then she was kind of doing the same thing. So, it's a bit... Pat will hold a baby tiger. bye, Sue. Lovely to see you. So I think I'm going to finish off here. So I hope that this has been useful. Not that I've got a huge amount done. I'm going to do some more live drawing on this boy anyway, just because I can, and it's quite nice to kind of, catch up with people and... chat away. And then I'll get this cat eye thing sorted, I think, for next week sometime, which would be quite nice. I'll get all of the resources loaded up onto Dropbox so that you can kind of download if you want, and then we can all draw cat eyes together, which I think could be quite fun actually. It's always nice to use different colours, so I think I might get that sorted today. And then if anybody does want to join me on one of the Zoom meet workshops, I've seen quite a lot of messages come through today. The 2nd of May one, that's completely full now. But I've got another one on the 9th of May. So if there are any spaces on that, do send me an email, and, and then I'll probably do some more after that anyway. But it's just a couple of hours on Zoom, and it's what I'm going to be doing is sort of like beginnery stuff. Starting out with your layers, choosing colours, that type of thing. So I think it'd be quite good, actually. And then if anybody wants to join me on Patreon, you'd be very welcome. I've got the RAM is going up on the... will start to go up on the 2nd of May. And then I've got this blessed swan that I haven't started yet that was going to be going up. But there's some really nice tutorials on there. There's my leopard and... a couple of horses and dogs, rabbit, there's a good variety of different ones, and it's a really nice place to be, I have to say. I've got my Facebook group on there as well, and I've got Discord, which is people chatting away and stuff, so it's all good. So anyway, oh, Vincent. Right, so I'm going to say goodbye, and I will catch you all very soon. And like I say, hope you enjoyed this one. Stay safe, everybody. Vincent, what are you doing? Stuck under the table. Stay safe, everybody, and I'll see you all very soon.